best part of waking up, put a little Jesus in your cup. Best part of waking up, put a little Jesus in your cup. Best part of waking up, put a little Jesus in your cup. Ooh, wake up with the Word. Hey, wake up with the Word. Man, and we're going to welcome our YouTube and Facebook brothers and sisters. Come on in. Come on in and get a seat. Amen. For the wake up word today and this week has been heart. Yeah. Heart. That's the word this week. And we thank God that God is just embedded in us, his word and his truth. He is the only one that understands and knows the heart. And he's helping us to know it even better. That Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 passage, trust and rely confidently on the Lord with all your heart. And do not rely on your own insight or understanding, and all your ways know and acknowledge and recognize him, and he will make your path straight and smooth, removing obstacles that block your way. Any obstacles in your way this morning? Come on. Anything in the way of your progress, of you moving forward? You serve the God who has the ability to remove those obstacles, to remove those blockages, and to make your path straight and smooth. I just had this visual immediately about the natural heart that can often have its complications of blockages. I remember when my mom had to go into the hospital. She was experiencing symptoms and didn't know what the symptoms were. Hard to breathe, getting tired easy and the like. So she goes into the hospital and they do an examination and they realize that there are blockages in her arteries. In other words, the blood pumping from the heart is not flowing in all of the tributaries like it should. Why? Because there are blockages there. Something has blocked some of the pathways. And because of the blockages, she's able to tell, or they are able to tell by examination, but she's also able to tell by the symptoms. I'm not the same. I'm fatigued. My breathing is off. One symptom after another symptom. You see, God in our physical bodies enable us to sense something's wrong by symptoms. And it's the same way in the spiritual. When there is a spiritual blockages of the heart, we experience symptoms of that. In fact, others probably will notice it before you. You know, all of a sudden you get angry easy. You fly off at the least bit of annoyance. You're not as thankful. You're not as welcoming. You're not as grateful. You're unforgiving. All of these are symptoms of blockages of the spiritual heart. And that's why his word in this powerful, wise proverb in this third chapter, 5 and 6 says, you want to remove the blockages that's in your spiritual heart. What my mama had to go through is they put in what they call a stent. They put a stent in the arteries, those tributaries that allow it to flow where there has been. And some, as I understand it, in some situations, it's like they also put in this balloon type thing and they blow it up just to expand it. And whether it's cholesterol or whatever it is that's clogging up the pathway for it to flow, that it can open it up and hopefully break some things up, or they have to put actually a stent in there that keeps it open because they want you to live and live well. And to live well, there must be a proper flow through the heart and its tributaries. Yeah, the heart will work overtime. It will work overtime when there are blockages and obstacles in the way. Are you getting this? But because they were able to open up those pathways in her heart, the blood flowed better and she felt better. And so it is in the spiritual. God wants to remove the blockages, the obstacles that are hindering the proper flow through our spiritual heart. He will make your path straight and smooth, removing obstacles that block your way. So how does he do that? I'm glad you asked. That's a real good question. He does that because before he performs his action, before he performs his surgery to make it happen for you so you can feel better, you must trust him. You must rely confidently on him with all your heart. Don't rely on your own insight. Don't rely on your own understanding. Don't rely on old wives' tales, and don't rely on people's opinions and their thoughts. But in all your ways, rely on, know, and acknowledge and recognize the one who created your heart. He created you and me. Yeah. And he says, if you trust me. Now, when my mama went in for that heart surgery and that procedure to put a stent in so that the blood can flow properly and the heart cannot work overtime, she had to trust the doctor, the surgeon. She had to trust the doctor that told her, I examined you and I discovered there was a blockage. She could not examine herself. She did not know. She could not say, this is my condition and I know what it is. It's a blockage, because she is not inept. She's not capable. She doesn't have that level of knowledge or wisdom to determine that. It required someone that was more proficient, someone who understood the heart, that was able to do an examination to determine that and then tell her there are blockages in your heart. Wow. And guess what? She had a choice. She had to trust them or not trust them. She could say, oh, I don't believe I'm having blockages in my heart. I don't think you're telling the truth. Look, I'm just going back home. I'm going to just do this. I'll take my own home remedies. Or trust that he saw something she could not see. Are y'all getting this? He was able, because of his expertise, because of his knowledge and wisdom, he was able to see something she couldn't see, to tell her what the problem was so that he could fix it. But she had to trust him. Not only did she trust the doctor that's telling her the diagnosis, then she's going to have to trust the surgeon or the one that's going to perform the procedure, because anything could go wrong in the process. But her goal and intent was, I want to feel better. I don't want to remain in the state that I'm in. And since I can't fix myself, I'm going to trust you, who knows more than I do, to fix it for me, so that at the end, I'll feel better. And so it is with God. So it is with the Lord. The Bible says, and we talked about this week, the condition of the heart. It is Jeremiah 17, deceitful above all things, and it is extremely sick. We got heart troubles. Who can understand it fully and know its secret motives? But I, the Lord, the wise one, the one who knows more than you know, who knows everything about your heart. He knows whether it's flowing properly or not. He knows whether there are obstacles and blockages in the way. I, the Lord, search and examine. Wow. Isn't that what the natural doctors do? You go through an MRI or a scan or whatever they do in order to determine, is there a blockage? My mama said what they did was, and through the cath lab, they would inject some kind of dye into the system so that the x-rays could show whether it's flowing through properly. They can't see it just through the blood flow. They had to inject something else in order to get a clear examination to see, is it flowing properly? And they could see through that if there are any blockages that would show up. What are they doing? Just exactly what the Lord does with our spiritual heart. They search and examine and they test. I, the Lord, search and examine the mind and I test the heart. My God. He and he alone that is able to examine and test this deceitful and extremely sick and desperately wicked heart of ours. He can understand it. He knows its secret motives. And not only will he search and examine and test, but he can fix. He's got a remedy. But you've got to trust him. Yeah, that's where it comes. You have to trust him. You've got to rely confidently on the Lord. You see, when they take you through those procedures, you have to trust, because here comes the anesthesiologist that's going to give you something that's going to put you out. You know, you're not even going to know where you're at. Mm-hmm. And you really have to trust. That's blind trust. I am going to allow you to put me to sleep and trust without me watching you and you telling me step by step what you're doing, I've got to rely confidently on your hands and your instruments and your knowledge and wisdom, that when I'm in recovery and I awaken, it's going to be well. Now, can I ask a question? If we can trust a man or a woman who is practicing medicine, if we can trust someone that doesn't have a 100% positive track record to put us to sleep, open us up, and perform delicate procedures to make us better, how much more should we trust and rely confidently on the Lord who made us? You're allowing an absolute stranger. You haven't gone to dinner and sat with their family and talked and understood about their life and their past. You don't know if they've got an alcohol problem or they've got some marital issues going on in their lives. You don't know their history, but you trust and you rely on them that they're going to get me through this surgery and I'm going to come out all right. How much more? Why is it difficult for us to trust and rely confidently on the Lord with all of our heart? God, I trust you completely. I trust you only. I trust you always. The words of the late Mom Chaz, who so faithfully served and was a part of our prayer line, going on to be with Jesus. She's with the one she trusted completely, only, and always. And God is calling for us to trust him with all our heart. Don't rely on your own insight, your understanding, your instinct, or what you think. It's not about that. We're not that wise. You don't have enough information. How are you going to go in and sit down and talk to the doctor who's got the results from your test, he got the MRI, he's got the pictures of your scans, he's telling you all that he sees, and you're then going to tell him, no, that's not right, that's not accurate, you're not seeing right, you don't know as much as they know. So why not trust him? You don't know as much as God knows, and he knows more than your doctor, he knows more than the surgeon. He knows it all. So even if you're going in under a doctor's care and you're being anesthetized for a surgeon, wouldn't it be wise not only to trust them, but really trust in the Lord? God, they're getting ready to put me under, but I'm trusting you. I rely confidently on you that you're going to bring me through. How many times have you prayed that, God, I pray and believe that you're going to guide the hands of the surgeons. No mishaps, no mistakes, that it's going to be fine. In the end, it's going to come out all right. Why? Because we learn how with all our heart, with our whole heart, I'm trusting you. I'm not going in with the jitters. I'm not going in fearful, but yet hanging on to some faith. No, I'm grabbing a hold of faith and believing that confidently God is going to handle my situation and bring me out. Acknowledge him. Recognize him. Listen, he said, in all your ways, there should not be a day that breaks and a night that falls, that in the course of that time, you haven't acknowledged the Lord. Because we're constantly doing things. You hearing me? In all of your ways and everything you do, put God in it. Include him in it. How many times have we in desperation of just pulling our hair out about a problem and an issue, and you calling everybody on your list, texting people until I need help, I'm in trouble, and the last person on the list is the Lord. After I've consulted everybody else, then I'm coming to God. No, he should be at the top of the list. Trust him. Quit leaning to your own understanding. And here's his reward. Here's his promise. He will make your path straight and smooth, removing obstacles that block your way. Somebody right now, your back is up against the wall. The clock is ticking. You're wondering, am I going to get out of this? I'm in a fix. That seemingly there is no way out. And I could hear the Lord said, remember Moses. Remember the Red Sea. Some things I set up on purpose. Glory to God. Sometimes I allow the enemy to track you and put you between a rock and a hard place so I can prove myself again. But if you don't see me in it, you'll miss it. You'll be frustrated. You'll be anxious. You'll make decisions you shouldn't make. Oh God, teach us how to trust. He is the answer. He will make your path straight and smooth. He will remove the obstacles that block your way. And then this week we said in Proverbs 4 and 23, and above all else, guard your heart. Now that you've established a trust and a confidence in God, and we sing that old song, I am gonna trust in the Lord. I am gonna trust in the Lord. I am gonna trust in the Lord till I die. How many times have we sang that? Yeah. Do you still trust when you can't trace him, when you can't track him? Do you still trust him? You used to. Guard your heart. The devil wants to rob you of your trust in the only one that has the remedies for your present problem. Guard your heart. Keep him in your heart. Because everything you do flows from it. In all your ways, acknowledge him. He'll make your path straight and smooth. Remove the obstacles. Come on. Because he wants your heart flowing in such a way that whatever you do, because what you do is the outflow of your heart. Whatever's in your heart, that's what you do. If evil's in your heart, you do evil. If good is in your heart, you do good. It is the core center of who you are. It is your being under your skin. It's just who you are and who you've become. That's why if you hang around with someone with a spiritually bad heart, it's contagious, it's infectious. You'll get one too. And you'll find out, you'll find yourself doing and saying and being the opposite of who you desire to be. Guard your heart, because everything you do is going to flow from it. Anybody listening and watching ever had a spiritual heart transplant? Anybody watching that say, I have been a recipient of a new heart? Yeah. I know it's a new heart because things I used to do, I don't do anymore. Things I used to say, I don't say anymore. Places I used to go, I don't go anymore. Why? Because I got a new heart. Somebody can say, I have a new heart. I know he's given me a new heart. Because I used to be an unforgiving person. Yeah. I've been hurt. I've been wounded. I've been abused. And I harbored unforgiveness in my heart. Ooh. But God, the only one that was able to come to my rescue, gave me a new heart. Ezekiel 36, God's heart transplant. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. Oh, I'm reminded of the testimony that we heard some weeks ago from our guest, Coach Sharon Wilson, sharing her powerful testimony about the abuse she has as a young girl by a deacon in the church that caused her to leave the church with an unforgiving heart because of what this man had done, violated, abused, and misused her. Not only did she leave the church, she wanted to leave life. Made it up in her mind, I'm going to put my kids to bed, I'm going to get in the car, and I'm going to drive, and I'm going to crash and burn. I'm tired. There's nothing worth living for. What a travesty that would be to die an eternal death with unforgiveness in your heart. But God had a better way. He opened that door, and in her driving to end her life, she drove into new life. Glory to God. Y'all heard her story. God brought her, took her to a place en route to end her life where God spoke expressly to her. I heard your cry, daughter. I haven't forgotten you. He is a compassionate God. Heard her cry. Turned her life around. And now she's helping others because he gave her a new heart. The same man she made known, I believe it was her stepfather, deacon in the church, that she and her sisters, who also were abused, God had given them such a new heart and put a new spirit in them that in his old age, when his body was breaking down, unable to care for himself, they cared for him until he departed this life. That can't happen if God doesn't give you a new heart. That it cannot happen unless God gives you a new spirit. He said, I will remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And maybe someone's struggling, just maybe someone's struggling right now because you got a bad heart. You got a heart that doesn't want to forgive and let go of the past. And it's hindering you. You got blockages. Those blockages will eventually come to your demise, your spiritual demise first, before your physical demise. It's eating you up on the inside like a cancer, and you can't let it go. Yet God has promised you a new heart and a new spirit. And you've got to trust him. You've got to trust him for it. Kevin LaVar wrote and sang a song that is so moving and powerful. The song says, I want a heart that forgives. heart full of love, one with compassion, just like yours above, one that overcomes evil with goodness and love, like it never happened, never holding a grudge. I want a heart that forgives, that lives and lets live, one that keeps loving over and over again, one that men can offend, cause your words deep within, one that loves without price, like you, Lord Jesus Christ. I want a heart that loves everybody, even my enemies. I want to love like you, be like you, just like you did. I want a heart that forgives. I want a heart that forgives. Oh, I love that song. The lyrics go on and say, when the one that are closest and that I've not known the longest, they hurt me the most, I still want to love them just like you love me. Even though I'm hurting, God should know they hurt me deep. Oh, what a, I want a heart that forgives. When the pain is so deep and it's so hard for me to speak about it to anyone, just like your son, I give up my rights to hold it against them with hatred inside. I want a heart that loves everybody, even my enemies. I want to love like you, be like you, just like you did. I want to walk like you, talk like you, just like you did. I want to be like you, Jesus, just like you, Jesus Christ. I want a heart, because the heart that forgives, that's the heart that will live. Oh, that line is so powerful. The heart that forgives is the heart that will live, totally free from the pain of the past. And the heart that lets go, that's the heart that will know so much freedom. You want to be free? My answer is yes. Lord, I want to be free. My answer is yes. God, I'm tired of being bound. Father, my answer is yes. I don't want this in my life. Father, my answer is yes. God, I'm ready to let it go. Father, my answer is yes. I'm tired of saying no. My answer is yes. I know you got so much for me that's been hidden by my pride. You got so much for me, so much you want to do with my life. Father, help me let it go. Lord, you know it's been so long. Father, help me let it go. As I play to you this song, I don't want to be hindered by the spirit of offense. I don't want to be hindered by people that do me wrong. I want to love them like you love me. I want to love them like you love me. I want a heart. I want a heart that forgives. Isn't that powerful? Whew. That leaves me with this final passage. That's our charge, our command in Ephesians 4 and 32. Be kind and helpful to one another. Tender-hearted, compassionate, understanding, forgiving one another readily and freely, just as God in Christ also forgave you. I want a heart that forgives, that lives and lets live. One with compassion, just like yours above. One that overcomes evil with goodness and love, just like it never happened, never holding a grudge. I want a heart that forgives, if that's your heart's cry, that lives and lets live. One that keeps loving over and over again. One that men can't offend, cause your word's deep within. One that loves without price, like you, Lord Jesus Christ. I want a heart that loves everybody, even my enemies. Oh, that's one of the hardest things that we can embrace. Oh, I can love my friends. I can love my family, but love my enemies? Oh, it's a command. We have no choice. I want to be like you, live like you, just like you did. I want a heart that forgives. Father, in Jesus' name, help us all. We're all in trouble. We all have heart trouble, but you're still the remedy. And you're more than a stent that keeps it open so love can flow. You are the stent that enables me to love the unlovable, to reach the unreachable, to believe the unbelievable. Teach me how to be kind and helpful to others. Give me a tender heart. Take this heart of stone and make it a heart of flesh. Make me compassionate. Help me to be understanding, forgiving my brothers and my sisters readily and freely, the same way that you forgave me. And if you could forgive me out of all that I know about me, and you know much more, how much more should I have a heart that forgives? Father, we come in agreement. We touch and agree. Let the past be the past. We let it go. We forgive. Now help us to forget so that we can love the way you love us. But you said, as far as the east is from the west, you separated those things that kept us separate from you, from your sight, so that you could love us fully and purely. I want a heart that forgives. Thank you, Jesus. For this we give you praise. And for this we say, thank you. Heart, that's our wake up word this week. God's been doing some heart surgery. Has he been doing some heart surgery on you this week? I know he's been doing it on me. He's still working. Yeah. And when he finishes, let him roll you in recovery. In recovery, you don't just get right up, put your clothes on, and go on about your business. You have to lay there. You lay there for two reasons. You lay there so your body that's gone through a trauma of being fixed has to readjust and get itself together. And you lay there because the one that performed the operation wants to check you out. They want to observe you. They want to make sure that it went well. Maybe you're in recovery this morning from a spiritual heart transplant. Just rest and wait and trust. God has you, and he's going to bring you out better than you went in. That abuse of your past is not going to be your demise. That trauma from yesterday is not going to be the end of who you are, because God has a plan and a purpose in store for you. Come on, Joseph. Your brothers tried to take you out, but you went from the pit to the palace, and you found yourself being a blessing to them when they had withheld blessings from you. That's a heart that forgives. Oh God, thank you for this journey of the heart this week. You're teaching us and you're showing us what's good for us. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Going to our chat board to see who's talking this morning on this beautiful Friday morning. Amen. Ivory, God bless you. I see you, Sharon Arnold, Pastor Tonda, Jimmy and Brenda Ward, Haywood and Lisa, God bless you. Yolanda, Theola, good to see you again, sis. Love you. Candace and Curry Staples, God is good. Kadia, Phyllis, Della, God bless you. Yes. Mm-hmm. Judy, intercessor, God bless you. Thank God for you. Thank you for connecting. Madeline, blessings to you. Carmen O'Neill, God bless you. Got your message yesterday. Looking forward to you serving on today. Maybell, God bless you. Thank you, Father. Brenda Butler, God bless you. Good to see you this morning in the wake up room. Isn't God good? I want a heart that forgives, that lives and lets live. That line is so powerful. I want the kind of heart that I release my brother and my sister from death. Mm-hmm. Unforgiveness will leave people shut up and locked. But not only am I going to live, I'm going to let them live. Without judgment, without repercussions, without holding a grudge. You can live freely. We can smile when we see one another. We can rejoice in our company again. God is good. All right. Going down the list. Pastor Sharon, God bless you, sis. Thank God for you. And we celebrate you now again, not only for your 70th birthday, but the 40 years of that 70 that God allowed you to birth the vision of the Upon This Rock Ministries 40 years ago in your life. And now he's rebirthing a new home, a new vision that God is bringing forth. And we celebrate. Only God can do that. Just when you think it's down to the end of your life, God says, no, new beginnings. He speaks new beginnings. Only God can do it. Yvette Candy, I see your request. We ask that no one actually put any specific requests from those on the line that don't know you. We want to avoid any scams. There's too many scams online. I'm not saying yours is a scam, but it could very well be. And I caution anyone without really knowing a person to just respond to requests for money or the like. Prayerfully, you're connected to a church. You can certainly contact the Streams Church, and we go through the necessary vetting to make sure you're real and that your problem is real, and offer you ways of assistance and help. But again, we ask that you not post. Generally, those that do this and post are those that are not, have not connected. And in many cases, I'm not saying this is the case, in many cases, you got people that scam on prayer lines and spiritual podcasts for help. And we don't want people to be misused or abused in the process. So please, if you would, you can log on to thestreams.org on our prayer requests, and we can certainly have someone connect with you. Amen. God bless you. Pastor Lisa, God bless you today. God bless you. I see you. Brenda Butler. Yeah, I see you. That's right, Brenda. Give me a clean heart. We all calling for that. Yes. I want a heart that forgives, lives and lets live. All right. And so we, in fact, we ended this prayer with, we don't know how, if this request is genuine or not, but God, if it is, we pray that you would open the door and make a way for this, this person to receive their need. You're a God that supplies all needs according to your riches and glory. So we trust you today to do that on their behalf. And Father, if it's not right, God, Lord, I just come against every scammer that takes advantage of innocent people with benevolent hearts. God, that you would give us discernment. Give us discernment to know the difference between, and that no one be deceived. In Jesus' name. Give us a clean heart, God. We have a heart to give and a heart to forgive. But we need your direction and your clarity. And I know, believe that you'll do just that. It's been a good week. How's your heart doing? How's it beating? Amen. Let it beat with the beat of the heart of God. Amen. Who gives us direction, clarity, empowerment, assignments to advance the kingdom of God, the kingdom of love. Amen. Let that be your mission. Look, I'm excited. Tomorrow is the day. Did y'all hear what I said? Tomorrow is the day that we gather for this worship experience, music from the rock at the Streams New Church, 3425 Boulevard Place. We're going to be gathering in at 2 p.m. on tomorrow. Don't miss it. 2 p.m. tomorrow for this powerful worship experience, music from the rock, the music from the Abundance Rock Passion Play after a 40-year run that ended last year. The music, the sound still continues, and it's going to happen at the Streams Church, 3425 Boulevard Place. Amen. All of a sudden, people picking up quick on these few remaining tickets, and you can get yours now. Do it now. Only $20. Just go to utrpro.com and order your tickets today. Get your family out. Bring them a great Saturday afternoon, wonderful time on something to celebrate in this Easter resurrection season. This Sunday's Palm Sunday weekend, and it's going to be a powerful time. And I want you to make sure that you're in the house Saturday. That's tomorrow at 2 p.m. Listen, if you come from 12 to 1, from 12 noon to 1 p.m., you can tour our lower level and just see the new home or venue space for Abundance Rock Ministries. Amen. Already has a stage, and the setting is just right for some of the new, smaller, powerful productions that the Lord is allowing the Abundance Rock Ministries to present to you and to many. It's going to happen. And from 12 to 1, you'll get a chance to go to the lower level and to see that. There's going to be some light refreshments served, and it's just a wonderful fellowship that's going to be taking place. So come on out. And then at 1 p.m., the sanctuary doors open for you to go in and find your seat for VIP ticket holders. You get to go in 30 minutes earlier at 12:30 and come in and find your seat. It's going to be good. Now, if you don't get there early and you don't get a chance to go down through the 1 hour, 12 to 1 time frame, you can immediately following, you have an opportunity to go down and just to view the area and before you head home. It's a wonderful time. It's a wonderful season. It's a season of acceleration. God is showing it. God is proving it. And we want you to get a taste of the wonderful things that God is doing. Go online now. Get your ticket now. Don't think about it. $20. You can sacrifice your lunch today and get a ticket. UTRPRO.com. Only general seating tickets available. VIP is already sold out, but we still have a few tickets left of general seating. Make sure you're in the house. Tomorrow is going to be an awesome experience. Amen. All right. Well, I'm excited again. Always never want to stop thanking each of you who have sown and made a pledge, a commitment seed into our new church edifice. We're asking for 100 people to pledge, to commit $1,000 seed towards our $100,000 goal in 2024, an accelerated seed. And you can do that by going to our website, thestreams.org/commitment. Those of you that have already made a pledge commitment, thank you. And many of you have already just given the one-time seed that you've already sown it. Some of you are just doing it in segments, maybe $100 a month or however you want to do it, and they're still coming in. And I want to say thank you for your faithfulness, your faith in the vision God has given us, amen, and your faithfulness in continuing to pray and support and to sow into what God is doing. We're blessed because of you, amen, and the God in you. And we are destined to see the mighty hand of God move greatly in the place that he has planted us. We shall bloom and blossom where he's planted us. In fact, we're getting ready to do some of that as we celebrate through the entire month of April. April celebration, celebrating our new church home. And every Sunday morning at 10:15, every Friday evening at 7 p.m., there's going to be guest ministers and guest churches that are going to be coming. We're inviting to come from Cincinnati, Houston, Texas, Grand Rapids, Michigan, Youngstown, Ohio, guests from on Sunday. And then on Friday, our local pastors and friends who have been very supportive of us. And as we've been going through this 20-year journey, Pastor Mark Brown, New Wineskin, Pastor Donald Golder from Temple of Praise, Bishop John Ramsey from New Life, Pastor Hensley Green from Emmaus, and there are more. I wish I could expand more Fridays in April, because there are some more pastors and leaders in the city that have been a blessing to us, and we could only select so many. But a big God bless you, and thank you just for being who you are. But you get to come and celebrate with us. And on the final Sunday of our celebration is yours truly. It's my 69th rotation around the sun. Amen. I'll be celebrating 69 years on the planet. Amen. And I am excited about the next 69 more years. Amen. So you get to come and celebrate after that Sunday service. We're going to have a special dinner prepared, a celebration dinner, and as we just celebrate what God has done. I love you with the love of the Lord, and I'm just grateful for who you are. Amen. And I thank God for your heart. Can I say that? I thank God for your heart, your benevolent heart, your heart of love, your heart of caring, your heart that has supported us, your heart that has prayed for us, your heart that has believed with us through this journey will never be forgotten. Your labor of love will never be forgotten. Just even your prayers, your silent prayers, and those that connect daily on the prayer line or to wake up word, breathe in a prayer this way. We are where we are because of your faithfulness to God. And I got to say, thank you, thank you, thank you for being who you are and having the kind of heart that tells the story that blesses us all. Well, I got to go. It's hard to go when there's love in the room. but I got to go. Hope to see you tomorrow. All right. I'm going to see you tomorrow in the Streams Church. Amen. 2 p.m. for Music from the Rock. And the best part of waking up, what you going to do? Put a little Jesus in your cup. Everything is going to be all right. God bless. Best part of waking up, put a little Jesus in your cup. Best part of waking up, put a little Jesus in your cup. Best part of waking up, put a little Jesus in your cup. Ooh, wake up with the Word. Wake up with the Word.